just do what we talked about, answer the questions as directly as possible. Don't go on off any weird tangents. You can't curse during these, okay?
What have you said, Clive?
Look, my name's Matt.
No, it isn't.
I've known you
for 10 years. It's Clive. Look at your name tag. It says Clive.
It doesn't say Clive.
Look at it.
No.
Look at it. No, look at your name tag. Major look.
Dryck, you can't...
Never gets old.
Picture this. The year is 1987. You realize that the packet of Smarties you've just eaten is actually ecstasy, and the dead hooker in your trunk has just woken up. This is how all great careers start, mine included. I'm Dryck Apelsin, and welcome to my retrospective career. Everything beautiful, all the time, always, with me, number one visionary, Dryck Apelsin, subcolon, I'm the greatest showman, subcolon, George Lucas can eat my ass. Thank you. Why do I make film? Well, for one, the money, for two, the pussy, but most importantly, to capture the beauty in the world around us. There's the seven wonders of the world. You know, the pyramids, the Colosseum, the Eiffel Tower, the Empire State Building, a 1968 Chevy Impala, this bottle of Chardonnay I found in my kitchen, and the duck-billed platypus. But I think the eighth wonder of the world is film. Film is what brings us together, and it's what tears us apart, and it's what brings us back together again in time for the climax.
Hi, my name's Matt. I'm Drake's agent. Working with him is... I can't say fun.
Dryck Apelsin is the reason I took up smoking.
One time Dryck met George Lucas, he yelled at him that this is what Alexander Graham Bell wanted movies to be like. I worry for him sometimes. And then he threw a lamp at the wall and ran out talking about Rango.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
Okay, so I don't agree with Dryck on a lot of stuff personally, but I'll admit I can separate art from the artist. He's a pretty competent director.
Watching a Dryck Apelsin movie is like getting your eyeballs acupunctured while touring the Guggenheim on crack. My favorite director used to be Quentin Tam Tamborino, but ever since I saw Dryck Apelsin's first picture, Ghost Farm, my life was forever changed. When I finished the movie on DVD, I turned to my mom and looked in her cold, dead eyes and said, "Mom, I'm moving to California to be an actor." And she said nothing, so I kind of took that as a yes.
Despite this luxurious appearance that you see before you now, I wasn't always this giant of industry, this towering, beautiful man you see before you. I came from humble beginnings, and I didn't have, you know, the set or the props or the actors that I wanted. I didn't have the dream actors for the role, so I had to, you know, go with whatever I had around, including, you know, stuffed animals. So I made my beginning in Webkinz videography. And I appreciate my roots. I think that's part of why my doctor diagnosed me with having some weird sort of psychological animal sexual disorder. This is a preview from the upcoming Dryck and the Apple Sinners EP, The Rango Tango. Going downtown with my best friend George. We're gonna eat a milkshake. Eating the milkshake like we're eating pork.
Dryck is always telling me and his other producers that we need to be more fashionable. Dryck, Jesus Christ. He's always giving me gold chains and shit. There was this one time there was a power outage like 5 years ago at the studio we were working at, and he tried to pierce my ear in the dark. It just got infected.
They say you should never work with children or animals, but I say children are animals. They're disgusting, they're untamed, they poop all over the place.
Alright, so you're just gonna sit right there.
Relax, I got this. Dryck Apelsin is the most masculine filmmaker I've ever seen. I like to watch his movies while I'm crushing brewskis and pumping iron at the gym with my boys. Also, I really admire his use of shot composition.
Ultimately, the point of why we're here, it's not the numerous criminal charges against me or all my tumultuous love affairs with various Hollywood celebrities. It's to talk about my impressive filmography. So I'm gonna break it down point by point, all of my films. First up, we have Ghost Farm, the charming love story between a man and the ghost of his dog. I was accused of both necrophilia and bestiality, but ultimately, I got my foot in the industry and I made a name for myself as an avant-garde filmmaker who made bold choices. Second up, The Matador of St. Bilquis, the love story between a man and his bull. Again, charged with bestiality, but I dropped the necrophiliac aspect of my career, so I was making strides towards more mainstream success. Third, A Pool of Water, the assassin's tale of revenge about a man whose wife was drowned in a pool of water, and he goes to hunt, as the title implies, and he goes to hunt down the men who killed her, using only a carrot and another carrot as his weapons. Fifth was an ode to Paul Giamatti, which I made with my longtime collaborator, Paul Giamatti. It was an ode to him, as the title implies. My seventh film was Sir, which told the charming love story between a woman and the man she thought was her father, but it turns out that he actually wasn't. So it was a series of mistaken identities. She had to find out who her real father was and then have sex with him instead of this imposter. My eighth film, Angry Angus, was about a man who made certified Angus beef for a living. That's it. That's all there was to it. It was just a bunch of product placement.
One time, Drake told me that if he ever won an award of any kind, it was going straight in his ass. And I didn't believe him.
Yeah, I mean, God, what can I say? I'm such a good director. I've never seen a movie that I haven't directed. I don't, other than Rango, of course. Other than that, I only watch my own movies. I mean, why settle for the rest when you can have the best, you know? Thank you.